Good evening, everybody. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining the City of Henderson's live stream performance of Waddie Mitchell. First, we would like to thank the National Endowment for the Humanities and Nevada Humanities for their support in this program. And then second, I would like to tell you all where the restroom is. So for those of you joining us in person, the restroom is at the farthest left exit corner. For those of you at home, we hope that you know where your restroom is. So we also want to thank everyone who came in person for enduring a little bit of our construction. This place got revamped, so we're very proud to show it off, but there's still a few finishing touches to go. So thank you for enduring that with us. But we also would like to ask and request that everyone, even those at home, turn off your cell phone or put it to silent so that you can all be present, be in the moment with your families, with those around you, listen to Waddie's words, and just enjoy the evening. So without further ado, ladies and gents, here is Waddie Mitchell.
Dadgum the luck. This dad-burned truck is up and broken down way out here in Nowheresville, at least 10 miles from town, and I'll have to hike. Because it ain't like I'm apt to hitch a ride this late at night, because folks that ride are snuggled tight inside. Won't you know, it's gonna snow. Me without a coat. Ain't this bliss? It's times like this really get my goat. Now, let me see. There might just be, if I remember right, a real good chance that there's a ranch around the bend of mine. And there she lay. Oh, glory day, I'll not be walking back, for up ahead's a small homestead and a welcome sight at that. Oh, I know the time, but he shouldn't mind. Most ranching folks take pride in doing deeds for them in need. I'll ask him for a ride. But I suppose the way it goes, I ain't the first to ask for help this way, and he just may be jaded towards the task. There's probably them that's bothered him on nights like this before. Come slinking up like hungry pups begging at his door, then never say, I'd like to pay you for your help and time. No, they just take, never make amends of any kind. You can't blame the guy for thinking I'd be like all the rest. It's way past 10. Here I barge in, make myself a pest. And he'd be right. Because his whole night of peace would be disturbed. If it were me, I'd surely be a little bit perturbed. But keep in mind, I'm not that kind. I'd make it right by him. I'm cold and soaked. My pickup croaked. I'm miles from a friend. And what's probably more is he'll get the door and greet me with a frown. Make me feel like I'm a heel. Cuss me up and down. Treat me rude. Act real crude. Pretend like he don't care. He might get his gun. Think it fun to run me out of there. Or sick as mud, or charge me what would be a hefty fee. Look, I'd pay his price if he was nice, but he ain't gonna be. You know, I've had enough of that guy's guff. I won't be made his clown. I won't lower myself to ask his help. I'll hoof it back to town. Yeah, just for spite. I'll walk all night to heck with that guy's ride. True, maybe I will freeze and die, but I'll still have my pride. I know to some that must sound dumb. It even has me guessing. But then again, if I give in, he'd never learn his lesson. Thank you. I am privileged this evening, not so much just to introduce you to me, but to introduce you to cowboy poetry. I've had it in my life, my entire life, and I have spent 30 years now getting around the country trying to share it, and there's a whole bunch of you folks, and so you can't get to every place, even in 30 years, but what I can do is try to let you know you're not just here to see Waddie Mitchell. You're here to see the guys that influenced Waddie Mitchell. When I was about 14 years old, I was sleeping in the bunkhouse with the cowboys. And if I acted up, I didn't get to do that. So I knew how to just stay quiet. And I was sleeping, and I was awoke. A guy just started spitting the pole mount. And all the other cowboys were quiet. And I was listening pretty quick. I was picking up on the story, and he had me in tears. And I looked around to see if anybody was seeing me crying, because I didn't want that to happen. And I see tears in some of the other cowboys' eyes. And I said, that is something I want to do. A guy named Bruce Kiskaden wrote this. And as he recited that to me, made all difference. Though you're not exactly blue, yet you don't feel like you do in the winter or on the long, hot summer days. For your feelings and the weather seem to sort of go together. You're quiet in a dreamy autumn haze. When the last big steer is goaded up that chute and safely loaded and the summer crew has ceased to hit the ball, it's then a fella starts to drag into the home ranch with the wagon when they finish shipping cattle in the fall. There's only two men left to standing on the job for winter Brandon, your partner. He's loafing at your side in a brand new saddle creaking. But you never hear him speaking. You feel it's going to be a quiet ride. But you savvy one another. You know him like a brother. He's friendly. He's just quiet. That is all. For he's thinking as he's dragging to the home ranch with the wagon when they finish shipping cattle in the fall. And the cook, he leads the retreat, perched up high in a wagon seat with his old hat pulled down, furred on his head. Used to make that old team hustle. Now he doesn't move a muscle. Feller might imagine he's dead, except his old cob pipe is smoking. As he lets that team go poking, hitting every hump and holler in the road. No, cook ain't been drinking. He's just sitting there and thinking about the places, the people that he's knowed. You watch the dust a-trailing. Two little clouds a-sailing. Big mirage like lakes and timber tall. And it's lonesome when you're dragging to the home ranch with the wagon when they finish shipping cattle in the fall. Well, you build your camp that night. You got your fire burning bright, yet nobody seems to have a lot to say. In the spring, you sung and hollered, and now you get your supper swallowed, and you crawl into your blankets right away. And you watch the stars shining up there in that soft blue lining. Sniff that frosty night air, clear and cool. You hear the night horse shifting, and your memory starts to drifting back to that little village where you went to school. With its narrow, graveled streets and all them kids you used to meet in that common where you used to play baseball. Now, you're far away. Dragging to the home ranch with the wagon when they finish shipping cattle in the fall. And your schoolboy sweetheart, too. She had these eyes of honest blue. She's the best performer in the hometown talent show. Ah, he's only just a kid. But you liked her. Sure you did. Lord, that was 30 years ago. Your memory starts to roam from old Mexico to Nome, from the Rio Grande to the Powder River, of all the things you've seen and done. Some of them was lots of fun. But other things, they make you shiver. Like the kid named Reed. Got killed in that stampede. It was way up north. You helped him dig his grave. And your good friend, Jim, the boss, hung up on his horse and the boys couldn't reach in time to save. You was there when Ed got his and the kid that killed him still in prison. Lucky George, he's rich now, he's living high. Poor old Tom got off the worst. He got his leg broke, died of thirst. Lord, that must have been a horrible way to die. And the winners at the ranches, them old-time country dances, everybody there sociable and gay, used to lead them down the middle just to prance into the fiddle. Never thought of going home till break of day. No, there ain't much chance of sleeping when them memories come to creeping. Sometimes you swear you hear the voices call when a fellow starts to drag into the home ranch with the wagon, when they finish shipping cattle in the fall. Thank you. Thank you kindly. I hope you guys realize I brought this weather with me. We left the ranch day before yesterday, and it was snowing. And we drove out of the snow that afternoon, and we got to Ely and decided, well, let's stay here in Ely, and come out that next morning, and it was snowing. So I appreciate this a big time. I really do. They headed out the canyon. Late autumn in the snow, the old prospector and his mule were loaded, traveling slow. He'd button high his collar with his hat stuck down like glue, and they headed straight for Elko, because, well, they wanted to. He chewed a twist of something that'd most surely curl your hair. His long beard matched his steel gray eyes with their penetrating stare. He moved with calm demeanor, seemed fearless through and through, and he headed straight for Elko, because, well, he wanted to. His mule was short and wiry. His face was long and sad, and he had a way of traveling kind of like his owner had. They seemed to fit together, and their partnership was true, and they both headed straight for Elko, because, well, yeah. When they hoofed it into Elko, a bunch of cowboys gathered around. See, they'd just come off the desert, and they're shooting up the town. They spied that old prospector, and they decided what they'd do, so they all circled up around them, because, well, they one asked the old prospector if he'd ever learned to dance. No, he said real cautious, I ain't never had the chance. So the cowboy pulled a six gun. He said, well, I'm up to teaching you. And he danced that night in Elko just as if he'd wanted to. Yeah, he danced and dodged them bullets there just like a jumping jack till he counted six, ceased to dance, stepped swiftly to his pack. He held a shotgun in his hands. His voice was calm and cool. He said, Sonny, tell me something. You ever kiss a mule? Well, that young man's face contorted as he pondered this disgrace, and he stared with consternation at that shotgun in his face. He swallowed hard before he spoke. His voice came sharply through. He said, no, I ain't never kissed no mule. But I always wanted to. I got five kids. They're all girls except four of them. And, well, it's pretty hard to say kids anymore. The baby is 35, the oldest 45, so, yeah, I still like this little joke. I had a third son that had a hard time fitting in with everything that was going on around him. He'd had a girlfriend all through high school. Got out of high school and she left him for somebody else. Had a job and they were out cleaning out cattle guards on roads with a big pressure truck. And as they were coming up over a bend, a dad with a seven-year-old son, as they come over the bend and that just run right in front of them, and they run them the outfit over. The dad didn't die, but the child did. And he had a hard time with that. A couple other things happened, and he never was the type to ever come and ask me what I thought. But he did. And, you know, I wasn't prepared, for I told him everything that we know to tell him, you know, that we typically, nobody promises a rose garden, and you know, life can be tough. All these things. I knew when he went away, it was like I didn't even need to ask Dad for anything. So I wrote a poem to him. I gave it to him. About a year and a half later, he says, "How's that working on stage?" I said, "I don't use that on stage. That I wrote for you." And he said, "Well, I really wish you would. I read to some of my friends, and they're passing it around." I used to wonder why it takes so many scars for us to learn. Seems we can't relate to hot until our fingers have been burned. But like cream, destined to be butter, first we have to take our turn through that churn we call experiencing life. For we'd not know what's meant by wind if we never felt it blow. We can't judge the weight of burden till we've packed a heavy load, or would appreciate a ride until we've walked some lonesome road and broke the code to that experience in life. Because when you're fighting every dragon that you meet, you tend to learn the times to charge and to retreat. We need to know of good and bad, and of some rapture and some sad, if we're to make this life experience complete. We never see the joy and pleasure without knowing first the pain. And if we're truly to forgive, sometime we've had to bear the blame. And if there were no threat of loss, who would ever strive for gain while in this game we call experiencing life? Because it's through doing we learn there's wrong and right. And it's through feeling we learn sorrow from delight. And just believing there exists some chance of finding happiness will always pull us through the darkest of our nights. And when we accept, we'll have some triumphs and defeats, and we consent to take the bitter with the sweet. It's then those opposite extremes, with all those levels in between, can help to reconcile out our balance sheet. And so our life experience will have been complete. I ain't never been much for shopping. The fact is, I try to stay away from town, and except when shipping time comes, I ain't too easily found. But the day came when I had to go, so I left the kids with Ma, but before I left, she asked me, "Would you pick me up a bra?" Well, without thinking, I said, "Sure, how tough could that job be?" I bent down, kissed her, said, "I'll be back by 2 or 3. Well, when I'd done the things I needed to, I started to regret ever offering to buy that thing. I was working up a sweat. I crossed the street to that lady shop with my hat pulled over my eyes. I wasn't taking any chances. See, I didn't want to get recognized. Well, I walks right up to that sales clerk. I didn't even hem nor haw. I told lady straight out, "Ma'am, I'm here to buy a bra." Well, from behind, I heard some snickers, so I turned around to see at least 15 women in that store all gawking right at me. "What kind would you be looking for?" I just scratched my head. I'd only seen one kind before. "I thought bras was bras," I said. She gives me this disgusted look. Said, "Sir, that's where you are wrong. Come with me," I heard her say, and like a dog, I tagged along. She run me down this alley where them bras was on display. I thought my jaw'd hit the floor when I seen all this lingerie. Why, they had all these different styles and shapes like I'd not seen before. I figured I'd go crazy before I left that woman's store. They had bras you'd wear for 18 hours. They had bras that'd cross your heart. They had bras that'd lift and separate, and that was just the start. Heck, they had bras made you feel like you weren't wearing one at all. And bras that you could train in. You know, when you start off when you're small, Well, I finally made my mind up. I picked a black and lacy one. I told Lady, just bag that one right there up, ma'am. I figured I was done. But then she asked me for the size. I didn't hesitate. I knew them measurements by heart. I said 6 7/8. 6 7/8, she said. Surely that's not right. Well, yes, ma'am, I'm positive. I measured them last night. I thought she's going to go in shock. Must have took her by surprise when I told her that my wife's bust is the same as my hat size. You see, that's what I used to measure with. Hey, I figured it was fair, but if I'm wrong, I'm sorry, ma'am. That just drew another stare. Well, by now, a crowd had gathered, and they's all cracking up when the lady asked to see my hat so she could measure for a cup. When she finally had it figured, I'd give the gal her pay. I turned to leave the store, tipped my hat, and said good day. My wife had heard the whole story before I even made it home. See, she talked to 15 women that called her on the phone. She was still laughing, but by then I didn't care, because now she don't ask and I don't shop for no more women's wear. That was given to me years and years ago by a great Idaho cowboy named Bill Hershey. And we've had a lot of fun with that for a lot of years. We all kind of go through this, I suppose. Every once in a while, there's a good story. And you want to write the good story because it's a good story. Other times, some things happen and you still want to write about it because you learn something from it. When I first met up with Shorty, I was 16 and abrupt. I'd been raised around cows and horses, thought I knew which way was up. I'd landed a job on the 7S. I'd hired out to Buckaroo. I was to pull out with the wagon, and Shorty Daniels was on the crew. He was old already, little, thin, and unassuming, and the flame that burned his passion for this cowboy life was all-consuming. And I can't help but remember, as I stand here and reflect, how that man who wore the Blanchard spurs had gained that crew's respect. At night, sometimes he'd talk about his mother, school, and home. How at 14 years of age, he'd set out on his own. You see, he'd aimed to be a cowboy. So he worked free for a ranch, mucking stalls and digging postholes till he'd earned himself a chance. Then how he'd worked in Arizona, popping brush and tying off, spending winters on a camp job where the trails were awful rough. Then how he'd come out to Nevada where he'd spent these many years, and he'd think again of mother. His eyes would fill with tears, for he'd say, I never made it back to see her, for she died. And regrets he had about that were impossible to hide. I just thought him sentimental, old and foolish in his way. See, being young, I thought life was this endless wealth of days. He'd talk of ranches and outfits, different country he'd rode on, but his story seemed prehistoric, because now most of them were gone. He'd talk of friends he'd like to see and places that he'd been, and how come fall, he's going to take some time, go visit them again. But something always happened, and he'd never really go except his yearly junket to the Denver Livestock Show. Because work and life tied Shorty down, doing things he thought he should. Just weren't time to get around like he'd always wished he could. And on occasion, he'd get word that some old pal had died. He'd say, damn, could have seen him, but I didn't really try. And if that feller's name come up in a story later on, Shorty'd pause and blink a tear and say, I really should have gone. In the paper yesterday, it hurt me when I read that Shorty Daniels passed away while sleeping in his bed. I got them feelings that you get when a partner soul's been freed. I knew we'd lost another of the last few of a breed. Oh, I heard how Shorty had been sick and wasn't doing well, and I figured I'd take some time go visit him a spell. But, well, I never made it before old Shorty died. Damn. I could have seen him, but I didn't really try. And that made me start to think about some things on my back shelf, like friends I haven't seen for years, and how history repeats itself, how outfits that I've worked at have sold out and are no more, and I'm starting now to understand what Shorty choked up for. Oh, I suppose it's in the scheme of things. We'll all have some regrets, and I reckon it's just one more thing that living life begets. But I'll bet when Shorty's name comes up in a story later on, I'll likely pause, blink a tear, and say I really should have gone. They called him, I'm going to tell you the author of this first. His name is S. Omar Barker. He was born Omar Squire Barker. But when he got to be an adult, he changed it to S. Omar Barker. He just liked the letters in that sequence a lot better. His family had a ranch in Las Vegas, New Mexico, and the brand was the Lazy SOB, and he wanted to keep that going. They called him Pertineer Perkins, for unless that booger lied, he'd Pertineer done most everything that he had ever tried. He'd Pertineer been a preacher, and he Pertineer roped a bear. He met up with Comanches once, Pertineer lost his hair. He Pertineer wed an heiress who had money by the keg. Pertineer caught the measles once. Pertineer broke his leg. Pertineer been the trail boss, and according to his claim, he Pertineer shot Bill Hickok, which had Pertineer won him fame. Now, mostly all the fellers on that Lazy SB spread, they sort of took his talking with a grin, let him fight his head, but one named Tom McGinnis sort of told it to him rough. He said, look, you're riding for an outfit now where Pertineer ain't enough. We tie our last hopes to the horn. What we catch, we hold. Pertineer is one alibi we never do unfold. In fact, right now I'll tell you that no words I ever heard sounds plain so damn useless as that little pair Pertineer. Well, that's how old Tom McGinnis laid it out upon the line and lied to heap of engine talk. It sounded mighty fine. But one day, Tom McGinnis, while riding off alone, lamed his horse. Had to catch this neighbor Nestor's roan to ride back to the ranch on, but somewheres along the way, a bunch of Nestors held him up, and there was hell to pay. Tom said, I never stole the horse, just borrowed it to ride. But them Nestors hated cowboys, and they told him that he lied. They took him for a horse thief. They caught him with the goods, so they set right out to hang him in a nearby patch of woods. They tied a noose around his neck and throwed it over a limb, and Tom McGinnis, Pertineer knowed this was the last of him. Then suddenly, a shot rang out from somewheres up the hill. Them Nestors dropped their rope and run like Nestors sometimes will when bullets go to whizzing. Tom's heart leapt up with hope to see old Pertineer Perkins riding towards him at a lope. Looks like our Pertineer got here just in time, old Perkins said. See them Nestors hang you. Tom's face got kind of red. Yeah, Pertineer did. He Pertineer grinned. They Pertineer had me strung. Why, you're looking at a cowboy whose Pertineer just been hung, and also one who's changed his mind. For no words ever said can sound as good as Pertineer when a man's been Pertineer dead. We had a, I grew up on a ranch that was really remote. And we were the last people on the mill route. We had, they drive 33 miles of dirt road after they put the last mail out, and then 33 miles of dirt road to get to us. They didn't have to take it all the way up the house. They could leave it at the saddler's, but this particular mail guy really liked to bring it up the house because mom would always have coffee and a piece of pie or something for him. And he'd like to sit and visit, and we did. And he told me this story. And I thought it was his. I thought it was true. And so I wrote a poem about it. And then once I started traveling around the country, I found it in Chicago, and I found it in Louisiana. And I mean, the story's been around. But I still like to tell it my way. And now I forgot which one it is. Oh, yeah. We was trotting home for dinner. Our day thus far had been a winter. We'd been turning out some pears on railroad lees. I was riding with old Jim, and if I was asked to describe him, I'd have to say he was a cowboy masterpiece. We stopped to let our horses blow when in a canyon down below we spied a neighbor doing battle with a steer. That brute had sold and brushed up thick in some willows near the creek. A full-scale war had been declared, and that was clear. Now, I'd had cattle sold on me. It was obvious to see that a reconciliation wouldn't come, and from experience, I knew if he continued to pursue that fight, there'd be one of them hurt before it's done. Jim just rolled himself a smoke and snickered like it was a joke while we both sat and watched this feller fight his head. That cowboy'd cuss and froth and yelp. I suppose we should go and help, but old Jim then got philosophical and said, if he'd just let that brute calm down, then bring an old cow back around that steer, likely follow it to Oregon. I ain't saying it's wrong to fight if you've got to, and you're right. But before you do, it's good to know what side you're on. Like when we was maybe 6 and 9, me and my brother was inclined to get ourselves in trouble while we were trying to be good. Oh, it'd be our fault, sure enough, but it'd be innocent young kid stuff that would oftentimes just be misunderstood. Like one hot day, we'd gone to church in a pew. We took a perch. It had been raining, and the air was thick and wet, which made it hard to stay awake, as about as much as we could take it with the snoring and the preaching and the sweat. The gal who sat in front of him and me had, well, perspired profusely. And when she rose, her clothes were clinging, so to speak. Adding to this situation, on closer examination, we saw her dress had lodged itself between her cheeks. Sure looked uncomfortable in there. We couldn't help ourselves but stare, and being just waist high, we really saw it good. Not being one to leave things be, my brother pulls the dress out free, alleviating the whole problem where she stood. Well, she turns quick. He just smiled, never dreaming she'd be riled. But instead of thanks, she hit him with her purse, which knocked my brother to the ground. She glared at me, then turned around. Folks, things was bad. But trying to help, I made it worse. See, I knowed something made her mad to hit my brother like she had, and I figured it must be that dress, confound it. So using sweat marks for a guide, I turned my whole hand on its side, and I slipped it right back in the way we found it. This time, it was me that felt her wrath, which knocked my senses off their path. I carry purse scars with me to this day. I guess we got what we were due, and when we finally come to, I learned a lesson I'm going to share with you today. It ain't always smart to offer aid to situations you ain't made. History tells me not to fight that losing battle. It's like my daddy always said, son, sometimes best quit while you're ahead, because there ain't no figuring women or sold up cattle. There's a old cowboy poet that I suppose maybe no more than five or six really of the older cowboy poets are considered the classics. This is sure a classic. This fellow's name was boy, I tell you what, this getting old stuff. Henry Herbert Knibbs, K-N-I-B-B-S. And he's not recited near as much as a lot of those other guys I've been telling you about, but he has really found himself because he wrote well. Sunny summer day it was, while open in Delaramie, I overtook the walking man. I reined up, nodded how. He'd been a rider once, I knew. He smiled, but scarce aware of me. He said, "If you'd like me to, I'll tell my story now. They'll tell you that I'm crazy, that my wits have gone to glory, but you mustn't be believing every Western yarn you hear. The one I'm going to tell you is exceptional. It's a story that you've heard perhaps a dozen times, a dozen ways a year." So he whispered while the shadow of my pony walked beside him, "If good people go to heaven, good horses go to hell." I slung one leg across the horn and sideways, so I eyed him, for I've seen the phantom ponies loping round the big corral. And I've seen my pony, Yuma. Yes, the horse that died to save me, come and nicker at the golden bars while I stood down below calling, "Yuma, Yuma, Yuma." And I still wonder why God gave me such a friend, why I killed her. It was 20 years ago. You remember, it was lonely when we used to guard the cattle, when a man would ride the line for days and camp at night alone with nothing much to do but watch that sun rise up for battle and not a soul to talk to, or what's even worse, his own. So I taught my pony Yuma many tricks. She was near human. She'd rear, shake her head, pick up anything I dropped, till she grew as interested and as gentle as a woman, just to have me praise and pet her. But one day, teaching stopped. You see, three rustlers from the notch rode up. I knew there'd be trouble, but I sat my pony easy and I rolled a cigarette. We talked about the rodeo, when like a bursting bubble, the leader opened up the fight. I felt my arm grow wet. It was 3-1, but Yuma, like a rock, stood to that thunder, for she seemed to know my need. Two empty saddles when the one that tried at first to get me spurred up close and swung up under, and I swear I saw the trail to heaven in the muzzle of that gun. Well, I flinched. I played the coward. Up, I called, and at my calling reared my pony. She took his shot. I leveled quick, and twice I answered. In the smoke, I saw his twisted figure fall, and then, and I felt my Yuma quiver. 20 years, I paid the price for my life. 20 years and more Septembers, but I'll never rub the hoof marks from Yuma off my heart. Now I'm the walking man forever. But I still dream of mighty ranges in the silent mountain meadows in the glory of the stars, and I see the phantom ponies in the dawn and sunset changes, and I hear my human nicker just behind them golden bars. Sunny summer day it was. While opening to Laramie, I overtook a walking man. I reined up, nodded how. He walked beside me for a while. He scarcely was aware of me, but you know, I believe I understand him. You see, I know his story now. Did I ever tell you folks about that cross-eyed bull I bought? Well, you couldn't put him in a show. At least that's what I thought. But a friend come out and said, "Hold on, Parg. Let me have a look." "Well, them A's aren't bad. Just call a vet. His number's in the book." Well, I didn't have much time, so I rang up that vet next day. I said, "Doc, and I got me a cross-eyed bull. Could you come out right away?" Well, out he came. He looked. He thought. He took a tube of glass. He walked around behind that bull and shoved it in that little hole that's under the tail. And then the vet begins to blow. He blows and puffs and sucks. The eyes rotate and straighten out. The vet says, $50. 50 flaming bucks, I think. Now, there's a tidy sum for half a minute's work blowing up an old bull's glass tube. But still and all, I pay the vet. I had straightened out the eyes. I take the bull to the Elko show. We win the major prize. So I truck him around the state some. We're doing well. And then I have to take him home because his eyes go crossed again. Well, this time, no vet. I know the deal. I'll save myself the dough. I get a glass tube. I shove it in. Then I begin to blow. I blow and puff and blow. But still the eyes stay crossed. So I'm forced to ring that vet again and mourn the dough I've lost. Well, out he comes. A very knowing smile was on his face. He knew I tried to fix the bull. I left the tube in place. So he pulls it out, reverses it, then gives one mighty puff. I watch the bull, the eyes roll straight and straighten sure enough. So I pay the vet, and then I say, "Doc, one thing before you go, don't tell me that the secret's knowing in which end to blow." He said, "Oh no, Waddie, it ain't which end. You can blow from north or south, but you didn't think I'd use the end you'd had in your mouth." It's just a little graveyard on the rolling foothill plains. This is another Bruce Kiskaden. On a rolling foothill plains that was bleached in sun by summer and then swept by winter snows and rains. And there, a little bunch of settlers had gathered on an autumn day around this homemade lumber coffin with their last respects to pay. Weary men who wrung a living from a hard and arid land, and beside them stood their women, faded wives with toil-worn hands. But among us was one figure who was wiry, straight, and trim. Everyone amongst us knew him. He's the Bronco Twister, Jim. Just a bunch of hardened muscle, tempered with a savage grit, and he had the reputation of a man who'd never quit. He had helped build the coffin. I suppose he helped to dig the grave. And his instinct seemed to tell him how he really should behave. Well, we didn't have a preacher. The crowd was mighty slim, just two women with weak voices sang an old-time funeral hymn. And that's all we had for service. The old wife was sobbing there for her husband of a lifetime, being laid away without a prayer. Then she saw the Bronco Twister. She walked right up to him, put one trembling arm around him and said, "Pray. Please, won't you, Jim?" You could see his figure straighten and a look of quick surprise shoot across them swarthy features in his hard, daredevil eyes. He could handle any Bronco, and he never dodged a fight. It's the first time anybody had ever seen his face turn white. But he took his large sombrero off his rough and shaggy head. Now, I wish I could remember what that Bronco peeler said. Now, I wasn't educated on the range his youth was spent, but the maker of creation knew exactly what he meant. He looked over towards the mountains where the drifting shadows played. Silence must have reigned in heaven when they heard the way Jim prayed. Well, years have passed since that small funeral, that lonely graveyard lot, but gave us all a memory and a lot of food for thought as we stood beside a coffin with some freshly broken sod and this reckless Bronco breaker talking heart to heart with God. When the prayer had all been finished and the grave had all been filled on his half unbroken pony, he just rode back towards them hills. We all just watched him. Let him. There was nothing we could say. Since we gathered at that graveyard, it's been nearly 50 years with their joys and with their sorrows, with their hopes and with their fears. But I hope when I'm finished and they've laid me with the dead, maybe some old cowboy say a prayer above me. Just like that Bronco peeler said. The second time I was asked to be on the Johnny Carson show, the guy that hires everybody made an arrangement, and I made an arrangement to be on the phone so we could talk. And he said, "Waddie, they liked you last year, and we do want you back. But you got to remember, and we didn't tell you this last year, but this show, a bus driver just got off work, and he's coming home. He's trying to wind down, and he just wants it light and to be entertained before he goes to bed. So what we'd like you to do is write another poem like you did last year. And we want it funny. We want you to make people laugh. And we want it short." I said, "Well, you'll get 2 out of 3. So I went home and I wrote this, and This is again stories I'd heard other guys talk about and tell, just never put it into order. So, in a tavern booth, in the days of our youth, we sat wasting away precious time. And one day what ensued, though you may think it crude, is the plot for this story in rhyme. You see, Larry liked to bet, and he yelled where he sat in a voice that was screechy and high, "Hey, barkeep, I will bet a $10 bill I can bite my own right eye." Now, this keep overgrown for being congenial weren't known, and his conversations often lacked grace. And all the hours therein that we'd spent in that den, we never once saw a smile on his face. He glared at our friend with an evil-like grin. I sure didn't think he'd buy it, but he reached in the till, pulled out a bill, said, "I'd like to see you try it." Well, Larry popped out his glass eye, bit it not hard, then returned that thing to its socket. Then he picked up his winning all the time while he grinned and stuck it neat in his pocket. Tender's face, it turned red. Some cuss words was said. It weren't hard seeing he wasn't too tickled. Larry saw the despise in them bloodshot eyes and grinned that granny grin when he's pickled. "You're a strange sort of bloke. Most folks laugh at that joke, but you didn't," Larry said with a sigh. "But I'm of sporting men, so I'll bet one more tin I can bite my own left eye." "You couldn't be blind. I myself seen you find your way through tables and route to the John. You're trying to bluff. Think I've not guts enough? Well, I'm calling your hand, kid. You're on." Now, Larry weren't blind. That was easy to see. The keep thought he'd found his reprieve. So he laid down a 10 spot and folded his arms, but Larry had a trick up his sleeve. You see, Larry'd been kicked in the mouth as a kid by this horse he was trying to bite, and what few teeth were left after that episode some years later got lost in a fight. This time, he didn't pop out any glass eye, though he acted like he'd give it a try, but with the toothless grin of a man richer by 10, he used his false teeth to bite his left eye. Well, the bartender blew. He cussed Larry clean through. He said, "Take the money, get out of this place. I've been swindled today. You got most of my pay. You best leave while you still got a face." "I assure you, sir, it's all done in jest. I didn't mean to make you upset. I'll give you a go to win back your dough if you just care to make one more bet. Now, if you'll go down far to the end of the bar and place there a shot glass upright, I'll make a bet you won't regret, and most likely you'll be richer tonight. But I'll bet the 20 you had, then 10 more, I'll add that I can fill up a shot glass so far with nothing more than the juice from my lip full of snooze and not get one drop on your bar." Well, the bartender knew it was at least 20 foot along that bar made of inlaid hardwood, and although he known men who were good with their aim, no one was known to be that good. So he took up the bet, laid down those dough, that shot glass was placed quick and neat. Larry steps up spry, lets tobacco juice fly. Not a drop came within 7 feet. Larry was beat. Revenge was sweet. The keep was laughing. I knew it. The target was too far. He walked up with a grin, pocketed his win, grabbed a rag and started cleaning that bar. "Hey, what's with your grin? You're now into me, 10, he said, wiping the bar all the while. "Well, I bet my friends where they are that I could spit on your bar and you'd wipe it up with a smile." I wanted to do this poem just a little while ago, but I got it. Curly Fletcher. Okay, Curly Fletcher was, if you've ever heard the old cowboy song, "The Strawberry Roan," yeah, Curly Fletcher wrote that. And he had spent a little time in Northern California. I was out of place, they call it the Jarbidge Wilderness area now, but this is before that all got designated, and we were just, you camped out in the middle of nowhere. And he had been out there working for a guy named Shorty Prunty. And so Shorty said he wasn't too bad a help or anything, but all of a sudden he come to him and said, "Well," he says, I'm on my way, Shorty. Says, "What, does something go wrong?" He knows, "No, it's just time for me to go." Well, he found out that he had salted a mine up there on that Forest Service and then brought some dudes up and sold it to him, and he had a pocket full of money and away he went. But he wrote cowboy stuff. He sure did. And if you want to learn about the cowboy language, you want to read Bruce Cascadden and Curly Fletcher. And this is his little story, and I love it. A cowboy and his trusty pal were camped one night by an old corral. They was looking for calves with lengthy ear, keeping a line on the boss's steers. The summer work was long since through, and there's only the winter branding to do. And when he went to rest, there was frost on his bed, so he pulled his tarp up over his head and into his blankets. He burrowed deep, and he soon got warm and fell fast asleep. And he dreamed he was through with his wayward past. They'd landed him safe in heaven at last. And there's a city there with its pearly gates, and its golden streets were wide and straight, and marble palaces gleamed and shone, and angels sang around this great white throne. And outside there's trees and meadows green, a more beautiful range he'd never seen. Great rivers of the purest water flowed, though it never rained nor it never snowed. And he stood aside on the golden streets. There's heavy spurs on his booted feet, and his batwing shafts were laced with whang, but he listened and he watched as that angel sang. And he noticed he's the only one with a broad-brimmed hat and a big six-gun. So he said to Saint, say, I'd sure admire to be dressed out like one of them angel choir. And instead of these shafts and spurs and gun, you reckon is how that might get done? So they took him into a room aside, and they fastened wings on his tough and high, decked him out with a flowing robe like that lady who looks in a crystal globe. They give him a crown and a golden harp, and the frost lay thick on that cowboy's tarp. Well, he twanged on that harp, and he sang a while, but then he had a thought that made him smile, for he wasn't the type who'd sit and sing when they decked him out with a set of wings. He says, I'll bet these wings would do to show some mustangs a thing or two. Well, I'll jump a bunch, and I'll flop and swoop, and I'll kick their tails, and I'll yell and whoop, and I'll light a straddle of one of the things, and if he bucks me off, I'll simply fly. So he hunted wild horses in his dream, but all he found was this chariot team old Elijah drove up there. Pick on them be hardly fair, so he set himself beneath his tree and rested his crown upon his knee, and he was watching them beautiful angels go flying and fluttering to and fro. At last one landed and started to walk. She come up close, begin to talk. Her hair was a beautiful golden brown. She had dressed in a flimsy silken gown. She had dimpled cheeks, and her eyes were blue, and her fair, soft skin, it was beautiful, too. Well, the cowboy gazed on the angel's charms and attempted to grasp her within his arm. Stop, stop, she stop, stop, or I'll make complaints to the great white throne, the ruling saints. So the cowboy halted. I must confess, he failed to bestow his fond caress. He said, Miss Angel, this sure too bad, but this here country makes me sad. Where it's never night, it's always day, and the pretty ladies won't even play, and there's beautiful houses and golden streets, but no one sleeps and no one eats, and all this grass just going to seed because there ain't no critters to eat the feed. And all this, no, Miss Angel, it's sure too bad, but this here country makes me sad. So she asked him about his former life. She learned he'd never possessed a wife, but this little angel, so sweet and nice, informed him she'd been married twice. And both of her husbands had been quiet men. She thought if she had to do it again, she'd have to pick between just two, a sailor boy or a buckaroo. Then she set herself upon his knees, and she'd give his neck a hearty squeeze, and then the cowboy heard a squall from an old gray saint on that city wall, while he was flapping his robes and swinging his arms till a crowd had gathered in great alarm. And then the cowboy stood alone before the judge on that great white throne. What's this? the judge of creation cried. How come for him to get inside? Why, look at his face with that desert brown and them bandy legs neath that angel gown. He's a buckaroo. I know him well. We don't even allow them down to hell. Why, he hasn't been here half a day and has started an angel to go astray. We can't permit him to stay at all. Just throw him over the outside wall. So the saints and the angels, they give him a start, and he fell towards earth like a falling dart. But he don't remember the time he lit. See, he wakened for the tumble quit. The winter winds blew cold and sharp, and the frost lay thick on that cowboy's tarp. His beautiful vision had come to grief. So he baked a biscuit and fried some beef and drank some coffee black and strong. But all that day as he rode along, he thought of that saint who'd butted in and said to himself with a wicked grin, I'd like to get hold of that gray saint chap. I'd grab his whiskers and I'd change his map. I'd jump on his frame. I'd stomp around till I tromped him out of that saintly gown. And all of his life, as he roamed and toiled, he thought of that vision, so sadly spoiled by that meddlesome saint who caused it all when he sounded the alarm from the granite wall. He didn't repent. He didn't pray. But you know, he always wished they'd have let him stay. I'm going to leave you with this tonight. I was camped at a place called Miller Creek, and it's up there on the Bruno River, and right close to Idaho, in the big Black Rock Desert, and it's about far out as you can be. And I'd been camped there probably 6 weeks by then, and I would have had, they call a candy boy, somebody that'll take groceries and mail and everything up to these outlying camps. And he'd been by me twice. He'd bring you a big canvas sack, and then you'd need to leave a note with anything you needed in it. Sometimes you might need some tools to get something fixed or something, but mostly groceries and mail. And he'd been up, I was out, so I missed him. So I hadn't seen anybody in a long time. I get in one evening and had a little talk with my horse. Here you go, young feller. Let me take this saddle off your back. I'll get you a scoop of rolled oats, and we'll have us an evening chat. Now, let me curry some of that sweat off. I suppose that's the least I can do. Settle down now. Enjoy your grain. I'll turn you out when we're through. Well, we finished this up another day. That old sun is going down. I wonder why we say that when it's the earth that's spun around, because the sun, what is that? Boredom in your eye? I guess it don't make no difference to you if I call it sundown or earthrise. But regardless, we had us a good day, and I got what I needed to done. Neither one of us got hurt, and we managed to have us some fun. I got me high hopes for you, Brownie. Believe we'll make a good team. You've just got to slow down a little. In time, you'll know what I mean. Oh, when I was young, I was like you. But when working with cows, you'll find that enthusiasm's dandy. But experience is kind. Sort of lets an older feller work at a slower pace and still get as much accomplished on account of fewer mistakes. Now, let me have that foot up. I'll check on that old hoof crack. Hold yourself up. Darn it, no need to be hard on my back. Yeah, the clips I drew have done it. Looks like it's grown out fine. Won't hardly know you had one when I shoe you up next time. Say, but you caught that yearling slick. Do you like roping as much as you claim to? Maybe we should enter us a jackpot. Now, there'd be something to aim to. Yeah, but I don't see the boss allowing me to take you past them hillsides. You know nothing of trailering, and I don't reckon you ever will. You see, you and I are dying breed. Ain't many left like us these days. Well, I see Ed, the last year grain. Come on, Part. You go out and graze. Thanks for the chat. I've enjoyed it. I suppose I best head on inside and get me some supper swallowed. I'll catch you later, Pard. Thanks for the ride. Thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate you coming out. Thank you kindly. This is the first thing I've done in 16 months, and you couldn't even tell I was rusty, could you? Thank you so much. Please be careful going home.
Thank you, Waddie. Let's give it one more round of applause to Waddie Mitchell. That was awesome. That was really, really great. We're so glad to be having events back here on the Water Street Amphitheater. We can't wait for the whole plaza to open up. Thank you guys so much for joining us here. We hope you had a good time. For those of you joining us online, we hope you enjoyed as well. Guys, drive very safely, very carefully. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great night.